Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Omar Samko. I am a migration specialist at Teaching and Learning of Technology. On behalf of the Rutgers University Online Learning Conference, I'm delighted to introduce Mark Wise from the West Windsor Plainsboro Regional School District. We're pleased to have him present Authentic Assessments, How to Measure What Really Matters. During the presentation, please use the live Q&A option to ask any questions for the presenter. At the end of each presentation today, there will be a short survey displayed. Any feedback you can provide is greatly appreciated. Before we start, I'm also going to be putting in Mark's slide deck into the chat. So if anyone wants to follow along there, there'll be a few links that you can access, and I'll be putting that in just a few minutes. But Mark, take it away. We appreciate you for joining us today, and we're looking forward to what you have.
Cool. Thank you. Welcome, everyone. Thanks for having me and thanks for joining. We're going to be talking in this 50 minutes a little bit about what authentic assessment is and how you can modify probably what you already do to make it even more engaging and meaningful to your students. Again, the slide deck that Omar put in there is for you guys to follow along. There's going to be a lot of resources that we cover today, and I made sure to put lots of links so that if you wanted to check it out on your own time or for follow-up, it's all there for you, as well as a way to contact me via Twitter. And also on the slide deck, you'll see my email as well. Just a little bit of background. I know this is a Rutgers conference, and I've been exclusively pretty much in the K-12 space during my career. I taught for 10 years. Both in DC and in New Jersey, and then did my grad work up in the Massachusetts area for public policy, education policy, and then for the last 22 years, I've been an administrator in West Windsor Plainsboro Regional School District, just outside of Princeton. And so I've been doing this work, particularly with the backward design folks, the late Grant Wiggins and Jay McTighe, and feel that there's a lot of crossover between the K-12 space and the higher ed space. So I'll be able to share that with you guys today. So the first activity that I'd like us to do is this one. And that is of a specific experience that you had, a learning experience outside of education that you thought was quite profound. And it could be anything from learning how to make something new, to build something, to any kind of accomplishment that you learn sort of on your own outside of the education space. And I'd like you to write down on a post-it or just think off the top of your head, how did you feel during the learning process? And given those feelings and conditions that you had, emotions that you had, what were the conditions that had to exist in order for you to achieve success? So the two things again are, how did you feel during the learning process? And what were the conditions that existed that allowed you to achieve success? I'm just gonna give you guys a couple of minutes to consider that. And then what I'm gonna ask, and maybe in the discussion forum, you to post some of those, and then Omar can sort of send repeat those to me, and I'm gonna put those on the slide deck so we can talk about that.
So from Marta, we have the unlimited time to learn as one of them. Non-time bound learning.
Thank you, Marta.
We have persistence from Karen, a research journal, passionate about the topic, real world application, some YouTube tutorials, intrinsic motivation. Susan says reflection. Deborah says intellectual stimulation. Ryan has competition and risk of failure, aka embarrassment. And Deborah says feeling safe. Rajita also shares having a patient instructor and real passion from the instructor.
Okay, I'm gonna stop us there. And if you could see here, you guys came up with some great examples. No time limits, persistence, passion for the topic, real world application, learn at own pace, time for reflection. And you see the rest of the list. What's interesting, is there anything, and again, Omar, I don't know, we can't hear them, right? They're not able to speak into this. It's just through the chat.
Yeah, unfortunately.
Okay. No. Okay. I'm going to just share some of the things that I typically get from when I've done this in other places. And you'll see a very similar list. It's pretty consistent. I'm going to do the present mode so it's easier to see. And you see that there are certain common conditions that we're all coming up with. The idea that failure is okay, there wasn't real specific time pressure. You know, it didn't start on September 17th and end on the 19th and then get tested on it. That you had some personal intrinsic motivation or passion for it, and the person working with you had expertise and passion. There was a feeling of safety because if you failed, it was okay and was almost expected as part of the learning. That there was patience that was provided on the part of the person who has helped guiding you and encouragement. And you think about all this stuff that how we learn outside of school and this list. And if you think about how school typically is experienced by students, it's sometimes the opposite of these things. You know, that there are very strict time limits. There's not learning at your own pace, it's learning at the teacher's pace. Failure is not really accepted. There are some words of encouragement, but that's only if you're doing sort of what the teacher is asking of you. And there may or may not be real world application. Oftentimes it feels very disconnected from the real world. So really the focus today is how do we get school to look like the kind of learning that we do outside of school? And why is there such a great disconnect when we know that that's what really causes us to learn and to retain and to be motivated in our own process of learning? So I'm going to give you some examples here. I'm just going to ask you to try and follow this. And again, it's kind of hard with you guys not being able to talk, but if you're thinking about this on your own, I just sort of like you to play along. And if you ever wanted to turnkey this, you could do this with your own staff or your own colleagues. So I'm going to give you some words here. Okay, so if I asked you to how many of those words you could remember, I have a feeling, if we were doing this out loud, people usually get anywhere from 3 to 5 of those words that they could memorize and repeat back. But if I was able to share it this way about and tell the story of the parachuter who jumped and whose parachute ripped, but there was a haystack below when he landed, you would remember a lot more of those words. And again, it's because the analogy I'm trying to make is oftentimes in school, kids experience a lot of those terms as disconnected experiences, and they don't know what to do with them. There's no context or schema, but when it's provided, all those things seem to make sense. And we as the teachers know what all those words mean and why we're using them, but oftentimes the learner doesn't. So another analogy here is constellations. Like you look in the sky, students often perceive everything that's coming at them as very disconnected pieces of information or discrete skills. But if we were able to show them really what we're looking at, why we're looking at the sky or the stars that we really want them to focus on, all of a sudden when they're presented with this information again, they're going to start to see it differently. Or no, this is why I'm looking at the sky, or this is where in the sky that I really should look. This is what's important. And all of a sudden, those three dots in the middle form a belt that they now can see the whole picture. So I'd like you to take I know it's a lot of text. This is a bad slide. I like the quote from Linda Darling Hammond here because it ties in to what we're talking about today. So if everyone could just take a minute to read this quote. And I highlighted a couple pieces of it that I really think are relevant to today's discussion. And so you see here with Linda Darling Hammond's quote, really it's talking about that what we want kids to get out of school is sometimes disconnected from the pedagogy that we provide in school. And they really need to be revised. And we really need to rethink how we're teaching if we want to get kids to solve real world problems, to take up things that they really don't understand. I mean, if you think about what's happening in the world today with COVID and how we had to react to it, you know, it's a novel situation. We drew upon all these resources that we never thought we would have to do, but we had to do them. And that those that were able to do it successfully meant that, you know, they were able to achieve what they wanted to accomplish. And those that weren't able to, obviously it was, there was catastrophic results. And so we're going to be faced in this world with things that we're unprepared for, with questions and challenges. And so how do we get school to start to resemble that and train students for that kind of thinking rather than for thinking that has very concrete or sort of more convergent kind of thinking? There's another great quote here, is that the one really competitive skill is the skill of being able to learn. We need to produce people who know how to act when faced with situations that they're not prepared. And so the goal of teaching needs to be transfer. What are they going to do with this knowledge or skills outside of school? It's not to prepare kids so that they could do school well. It's how can they do school or the thinking that's provided in school outside? And, you know, there's a lot of educational researchers that are starting to think about transfer as the new basic skill, like how they do the work with the work that we're providing. And so this is the kind of thing that really we need to rethink how we write curriculum and the kinds of activities and assessments that we provide students. And so I want to take the next part of this session to sort of unpack the terms authentic assessment. And I came upon this, and this is a picture from 25 years ago in 1996, when I was teaching in Edison, New Jersey, and I was teaching AP government. And I decided to run for US Senate as would be the focus of the year, with the students creating the political party, creating the platform, and doing everything for the campaign. And I would teach the course through that project. I didn't know the term for it. I didn't have the jargon for it, but I just thought it would be a really cool way to teach about politics and get students to be motivated. So Jorge, I don't know if you could throw up that.
Mark Wise won't be going to this year, at least as a member, but he came a whole lot closer than anybody expected. CNN's Marianne McRae reports on a textbook case of democracy in action.
Mark Wise looks barely old enough to vote, much less run for Senate.
Then we'll do Constitution and Federalism, and then we'll do...
But run he did as part of an educational effort to get his high school students interested in the political process.
There are so many experiences that happened during this campaign that allowed students to do some real life learning.
The 30-year-old teacher of government and politics got enough signatures, 800, to get himself on the ballot as an independent candidate in New Jersey's recent Senate race.
It's probably one of the most exciting things that's happened to this high school in a real long time.
When it came time to tally the vote, Wise got more than he bargained for. 13,676 voters cast their ballot for him.
I really thought that we might get a couple hundred votes from maybe some of the students' parents and my own. But other than that, I really didn't think that this message would carry beyond this small group of people.
It probably showed that people were looking for a place to go. They were dismayed at the nasty tone of the campaign.
New Jersey had a really bad mudslinging campaign between Torricelli and Zimmer. So I think our positive message got out and it attracted more people to us.
Of course, 13,000 plus is a drop in the bucket compared to the more than 1 million votes that won the election for Bob Torricelli. But it's not bad for a campaign that raised no money and did little actual campaigning.
we approach this in a very serious manner, but not serious in terms of trying to win the election. And to get 13,000 plus votes, we thought was pretty significant.
Wise, along with his students, devised a campaign and a platform with special attention to those issues important to young people, like Social Security, college accessibility, and national service.
Typically, young people aren't consulted about what they think should be done concerning their own future.
We're not just apathetic, lazy people who watch MTV.
With the election over, Wise now faces a tough reality: how to make his future lesson plans as interesting as this last one. Marianne McRae, CNN, Edison, New Jersey.
Today.
So this was, again, feeling like I had taught AP government for a while, and it was just feeling like a vocabulary course. And I thought, is there any way that I could switch it up and be much more experiential? And this was sort of my foray into the idea of backward design and really thinking about the assessment as part of the learning, and starting with the project or the task up front and guiding the learning through there. So it wasn't at, we've done all this stuff with AP government, and now at the very end, we're going to do a run for Senate. It was run at the very start. That's our first day in the class. How are we going to do this? And then all the learning went through that project. And that was a year long. Actually, it lasted over a year because it, anyway, the school year ended and then I had a new group to take up for the election. But what it really transformed for me was this created the momentum and the flow for the learning throughout the year or throughout, for long stretches of the unit. It didn't mean that I didn't give tests, and it didn't mean that I didn't talk about other stuff, but we were grounded in this work and it was highly motivating. And even though we did this and people would think it would take time away from it, the scores that I got on the standardized AP scores were higher than I had ever gotten before. And I would chalk that up to that they were just much more motivated as learners during this time period than they ever had been. So let me just unpack a little bit about authentic performance tasks. So that we understand the different terms. So performance task, the idea that students get to apply their own learning to a novel situation. The authentic part of it is that there's a realistic context, that it's doing what real people do outside of the school situation within this discipline with that content or with those skills. And again, ideally, we should be mindful to incorporate student interests and experiences into this as much as possible. And we're going to talk about voice and choice a little bit later on. That there should be some novelty, that it's not, there's not a rote answer or a singular answer that the teacher's looking for, that the students have opportunities really to look at this about and come to answers the way they see it, the way they envision coming to it versus just sort of guess what's on the teacher's mind. And then the other thing is that there really is a false dichotomy, I think, that's played like, well, you either do this or you teach the stuff. And that knowledge or skill development is not mutually exclusive from this work. You have to have that as part of the work that you're doing, but that it's a means, not an ends in and of itself. So where do you get these ideas from? And obviously, like in this case, when I did that, it was within the content that I was teaching. But it could be in a need of your community or an issue that impacts the world. It's out there, but it needs to be grounded in something that's real and authentic. Again, it's really important that the task has a clear goal or purpose. So what are you going to have the kids do? Make a decision, solve a problem, communicate or design something, persuade. It should have something that you're asking of them that's very clear, so it's not nebulous. There's a target audience that's beyond the teacher or the refrigerator door that, you know, gets the gold star. Who is this for? Again, the authentic context, the real world constraint, if possible, if there's a budget, if there's a schedule, to build that into the task. That there's something that the students produce that's tangible, whether it be a product or performance, that's going to provide the evidence of both the application and for them to be able to explain their understanding. And we're going to talk about rubrics and how do you actually measure that, because a lot of times instructors get hung up on, well, I know what really matters, but I don't know how to measure it. It feels too subjective. And I'll talk to you about how to objectify what is the subjective. And that's the last part. The success criteria rubric is directly aligned to the goals or outcomes that were identified. And so I also want to distinguish between a project versus an authentic problem-based task, just so that we're, again, talking about the same thing. If it's a project, in answering these questions, you sort of get the sense of whether it's a project or authentic task. Does all the learning occur prior to the students engaging in the project? Then it's more of a project. If it's during, it's more authentic-based problem. Are there step-by-step directions that are very much formulaic for a predetermined outcome? It tends to be more project versus students are having choices of how they move forward, what the process is, even in the way that they display their information. And that's the third bullet. How does the outcome get displayed? Is it simply a dump? Here's all the information I know, and I'm going to show it to you however you guys set it up. Or are there really interesting and novel and unique ways for the students to show what they know and how they know it? And again, does it encourage personal connections and choice? And that's really important that they have some connection to this work. Again, even just drawing back to the example of the run for Senate, the students had to agree on not only the party name, you know, we created our own third party, but they had to agree on the platform. And so, you know, we only had four pieces to our platform because I had 135 students, and those were the only four pieces that everyone could agree on. So we weren't very much a viable candidate, but it didn't matter because it was really, I was more interested in making sure everyone felt 100% committed to what we were talking about versus the thought of actually winning. And so the idea in your work, you really want to make sure when you're designing this that the students do find that motivation, going back to like what we talked about at the start of when you were finding passion in stuff that you felt value in. We want to share that with the students as well. Oops, sorry. So there's a couple of different tracks of authentic tasks. There are your more set product track where there's a lot of guidance from the teacher. And again, if you're following along on the slide deck, there's some links to see what those look like. There's a more problem track, which has some guidance from the teacher. And this is where you present students with a problem or they identify a problem themselves, and then they work to resolve that. And then there's an open-ended, which is least guidance. And this is where the teacher sort of has a question that they share and the students have to figure out how they want to answer it or how they want to pursue in solving that. And again, I will show you examples of all these, but some of these links here provide examples of that. So the first example that I want to share actually comes from my own life with my son is as a second grader. He's now a junior, but in second grade, he was what was a typical boy, sort of reluctant reader writer. And I remember they were doing a author study on Jan Brett, who is a children's author, both illustrator and author. And typically when they were doing these kind of author studies, the teacher would ask, what did you like about the book? And my son would write, it was good, you know, or a couple of sentences, and then hand it in to the teacher, pictured on the left. For the Jan Brett author study, they said that they were going to actually ask the same question, but they were going to send it in to Jan Brett herself. They were going to write a letter to Jan Brett. And my son wrote four pages, albeit 28 font, you know, I don't know how many words were actually on a page, but he was really motivated to write. And again, the only thing that shifted, it was the same prompt. It just went from who he was turning it into. It went from the teacher to the actual author that they sent the letter. And he was much more engaged. And it just made me, again, it just resonated with me in the sense that that slight shift of same purpose, but different audience in an authentic audience in terms of the author themselves made all the difference in the world to him and to many of his classmates. Another example, again, at the elementary level, where the typical food web of predator-prey is discussed, to when a teacher then said, okay, what are we going to do to help prevent endangered species and protect them? And went to the New Jersey website, talked about the different levels of engagement that they could take part in. And then the students chose which species they wanted to sort of work with, and then which stakeholder would be the one that would have the most impact on their particular endangered species, and then do something for them. Again, a very typical sort of food webby kind of experience in science class became one of environmental advocacy, and very empowering and engaging to the learners. Here's another one again, and I'm using some of these elementary examples to show you that it's not something that just high schoolers and college age kids can do. This one was a fifth grade teacher that was traditionally doing a report on an issue facing the world, and she had the kids change it report to actually creating a plan for change. And what are they going to do to promote the change that they really wanted to see? And in this case, again, you could check it out on your own, but they wanted to address homelessness in New Jersey. And what can they do to prevent that, both in terms of create awareness, and what could they do in terms of making a change or making a difference? This is something that we did in our own district. This is, we used to do a very traditional research paper in seventh grade that kids hated, but they, you know, it was justified, like they've got to learn the research skills if they're going to go to high school, if they're then going to go to college. And the teachers changed it from a research paper to creating a documentary, that every kid has to create their own documentary. And they get to choose what they work on versus, again, previously the teachers would assign what kids would do the research on, or it was a very limited list that kids would pick. And, you know, if someone picked what you were really hoping for, you couldn't do it because, God forbid, two people should do the same research. And so they changed it to how has the United States evolved over time, and why does this topic matter in the larger picture of American history? And so that was the question. And then the students can choose whatever topic that they wanted to research and then present. And then they would post their documentary or try to send their documentary to some kind of stakeholder who they thought might be interested. So again, the work transcended the classroom. It was based on student interest, and it was still doing the research skills, but within a medium that was much more engaging to the learners and probably much more transferable in terms of skills. This was done in our eighth grade too. We had these literary book groups around social issues that they would study. And then what we did was extend that is to what social issue matters to you. And you can see on the left here, this just was a couple weeks ago, where these were issues that mattered to students, like the pink tax or body image or gender wage gap. And they would do surveys with in their community and among the teachers. That's how I got this. And then they create some kind of awareness or advocacy experience to try and create the change within the topic that they were most interested in, and then choose books that were aligned to the social issue that they were concerned with. So again, more about voice and choice, what the students really want to learn about. And it was still working on the literary skills that mattered to the teacher, but it was giving much more empowerment to the learner about what they were going to learn and what they were going to do with that learning. This is something that we do grade in our district, and we used to have sort of an end of year Model UN simulation, and we moved it to a global challenge where the students pick a topic of global development that they're most interested in. Everyone gets their first choice. And then within that choice, we break them into groups of five that are randomly assigned. They have 1 week to sort of talk about what what about that issue really matters to them? How are they attempting to solve it in a particular country or region? They present to an outside group of judges who score them, and then the top scoring teams actually get to present to experts in the field through Skype. And it takes place over 1 week in the second to last week of the school year. And it's incredibly engaging, and it allows us to sort of check for the skills that we're really looking for in terms of communication, in terms of problem solving, that was without any support from the teachers. This is totally student driven, and however they score, they score. We put kids together of all different abilities, and the judges never know who has an IEP or a 504 or anything like that. It's just scoring the kids on the basis of what they put together. And this last one is the idea of, in a film class, instead of just doing a handing in your project to the teacher, it's, hey, there's a real company that's looking for 2 to 5 minute films about this certain content. And we want you to send in and apply to this, there was some kind of award given here, but it was a sort of a short documentary on positive content. And so instead of, again, it going as a final landing spot, it was sent to this company, Lightbeam, as a way to, there's a real audience. Hey, you guys could win this. You could win this award, rather than just being something that is handed into the teacher. I believe earlier on in the discussion forum, someone said there was some competition. So these last two examples, there's a little bit of competition in that some kids got to Skype with real world experts, or in this case, some kids might win the award. A little bit of blood in the water is okay. It has nothing to do with the grade, but it gives a little bit of incentive that there's something beyond just getting a score on a piece of paper that matters. So there was a lot of content dump right there. I think this is a good place to at least pause and reflect. And so in the discussion forum, if you want to take a minute or two and at this point just ask some questions about what you're seeing or maybe how it might relate to the work that you're doing, I might be able to answer here or at least make sure that I'm coming to it, because what's just to preview what's coming next is a little bit about if, as you design this, what's your role as the instructor that's leading these kinds of tasks? Because just because it's student-centered doesn't mean it's teacher-absent. So that's what we're going to be talking about next. But this little pause here, if anyone wants to drop a question or a thought into the discussion forum. I'm going to use my good wait time as best I can. Okay. There's no questions at this point. I'm going to move on. So, as I said, this next part is really about how do you pull this off as an educator? And so, as we mentioned from the start, the context and schema matter. I use this analogy of mental Velcro, like what's going to make it stick for the students. So the first thing that really matters is that there's this felt need, like why am I learning what I'm learning? What does it matter to me? What am I going to be doing with this stuff, other than being tested on it 3 weeks from now? Why should I know this? So first thing, when you're designing your task, you have to create the felt need. And ideally that starts with a problem. Like, why is this happening? Look at this image. What's going on here? Has this always happened? What's the history of this? What can we do to solve it? It's got to be something that can sustain inquiry over time, that it really has to be something that creates that kids could get deeper into, that they're not going to like, okay, I got the answer and I'm done, or it's so challenging that I'll never be able to do it within the time frame that's provided. So you have to provide that, you know, that a little bit of the right amount of challenge within the time frame that you have. Authenticity. You know, on the left of this picture is, again, someone producing something. This was, I think, some kind of sustainable outdoor latrine that they were designing for the global challenge. On the right is, you know, poetry that they were producing to be published. Again, there's something beyond the teacher where this was going. And voice and choice. And so voice and choice, again, is a phrase that's out there. Many of you probably have heard about it, but what does it actually mean? So in terms of the questions asked, these are all, they all don't have to be here, but these are opportunities for where voice and choice can be heard. So what questions that are asked could come from the students. They don't have to come from you. You could give them sort of the intellectual guardrails, which they're operating within, but the questions that they ask and pursue can be their own. The use of time. Again, they get to, you could give them how they use their time, when they use their time, how they're getting together, who they're working with, the kinds of products to be created, the level of autonomy that you want, the texts and resources used that you can provide, some that are required and some that are choice, and the order of operations. This is really interesting. When we did the global challenge and they'd start their research, it drove teachers crazy that they started with the slide deck versus taking notes on research like the teachers did when they were doing it. And so if you really want to allow the students some choice in the matter, you have to sort of allow them to figure out how they do the best research and how they want to do it, rather than saying step one, step two, step three. So those are all opportunities provides for voice and choice.
Mark, I just want to butt in real quick. We got a comment from Susan. Yep. Says, rather than to lecture on importance of participating in new assessments, a new approach might be sharing past results and asking them to discuss. And then we had a question from Jessica. She asked, I struggle with this on the elementary level. Students seem to have a hard time with choice and or comprehending the why. Any tips?
Right. And I think in addressing that question, I think a lot of it, and again, I tried to show a couple of elementary examples. It's, you have to, with choice with elementary students, and I think with anyone, you have to provide those guardrails. Like what kind of choices are you providing? You're not providing a wide open field of choices, but you're providing a more narrow base of choices within the question that you want answered or within the task that you provided. For real specific examples with elementary, I'm gonna put in my email because I have a lot of elementary examples. And then if you wanted some specifically, I could then talk with you offline about what are some of those examples. But to get back to this point here, that one of the things I think that is really important in the authentic assessments is that there's reflection and feedback and revision during the process, not just after. Because what happens oftentimes with these tasks is that kids are asked to reflect at the very end. So how did you think you did? Or what changes would you make? Or here's where I thought you could have done better. Why not build that into part of the process? So they're getting that feedback and they're making those adjustments during, after it's too late. Because really, once you give that feedback or once feedback is given and there's a grade assigned to it, there's very little learning that takes place. Again, we talked about creating original and public products, if at all possible. It's really motivating that it goes beyond just the teacher as the final landing spot. And also the idea that it's a photo album versus a snapshot. It doesn't mean, think about us learning to drive and getting the driver's license. Yes, there's that final test, but there are multiple opportunities that you're given and have to show that you understand, from the written test to maybe simulation to, you know, identifying parts of the car wouldn't be really necessary to learn to drive, but maybe identifying some key components of where the blinkers are or where your wheels are is sort of knowledge that you need to know. So we take it as a whole photo album, that whenever you do these authentic assessment tasks, there needs to be both sort of these performance pieces, but also the more traditional pieces that are key content or skills that you want the students to know. And this sort of talks to a little bit about that. This is out of the backward design work, that there's your traditional quizzes and tests might be with the content that's worth being familiar with or important to know and do, but the enduring understandings, the big things, are really much more better assessed through performance tasks and projects. So again, what's your role during this process? And I had mentioned before that student-centered doesn't mean teacher absent. Really that you're much more the GPS in this situation, that you've identified a destination that you want the students to get to, and you're going to help guide them there. And if they make a left when they should have made a right, no big deal. We just reorient them to help get to the final destination. And there's multiple ways to get there. You might want the fastest route. You might want a route that doesn't have tolls, but you're sort of, again, assigning where you want them to land and helping guide them to get there without it being overtly formulaic. Again, the extending the analogy, the ferry versus the bridge, it's we want to move away from everyone getting on one spot and being delivered to the end versus a bridge, which you could take upper level or lower level. And that it's, again, people can move at their own pace getting over there. But there are guardrails. It's not that wide open expanse. You could provide mini lessons as appropriate. How-to sheets, and someone had mentioned that before in the beginning with YouTube tutorials, that we don't have to provide all the information and we don't have to give everyone the same thing at the same time. If you need to know how to do this, there's a YouTube tutorial. If you already know how to do it, great. But you don't have to assume that everyone's at a starter position, a beginning spot, or everyone's an expert. Allowing these sort of how-to tutorials allows the students to access them when they need it. You could have individual or small group conferences. Again, it doesn't mitigate that the teacher is no longer important in this process just because they're moving on a project that they're self-determined with. There's activity lists that you could provide for students, and you could sort of track of what are they completing and in what order. Some things could be required, some things could be optional. And again, I've seen this done with HyperDocs as well. And again, there's an example here with that. For those that really want to check in and see where the kids are at, there are facilitation grids to sort of see who's doing what, have they completed it, to what degree, where you could check in and students about, hey, I've noticed that you're moving at this pace, or these first few components, I see that you have a more beginner sort of understanding. We need to move you towards more advanced. And progress charts are another way to do the sort of the same exact thing. Quizzes during this time period could be much more as a formative assessment. So you could check in with students. Not only are they right or wrong, but was it a simple mistake or that they really don't understand? That would then inform your own teaching. I know I have 4 minutes left, so I'm just going to sort of go through this last little part. We mentioned at the start that there needs to be some real clear success criteria. And so that's typically rubrics that we're designing there. And so there's a couple things to think about when it comes to rubrics. One is we have to make sure we're measuring what matters. So when we talked about, did they persuade or did they really explain the concept the way that you wanted? Did they use the right argument? Those are the kinds of things that we have to make sure that we're using in our rubric. This example of attending a comedy show, oftentimes when we do rubrics in school, we measure everything else in the comedy routine other than did it make the audience laugh. So whatever we're doing, make sure whatever the impact is that you wanted on the audience, that's part of the rubric. Secondly, make sure that the criteria is weighed appropriately. So that here's an example that from the left to the right, just because you have four criteria doesn't mean that mechanics have to be the same amount percentage-wise as the others. So that really you could change the criteria, the weight of the criteria, depending on what matters most to you. Third, check your math. That if you're using, let's say, a four-point rubric and the three was the meets the standard, if a kid completely got a three and you're using that as your scoring, that's 75%. So potentially they could get a C for meeting the standard. So just make sure that your numbers up top really match what you value. And if the third column really is your A minus B plus sort of column, you have to make sure that you have the numbers that match that. If you can, utilize can do versus can't do language. And so the great example is the swim test. You know, it talks about kids being able to blow bubbles for 30 seconds and you're a tadpole. It doesn't say at the tadpole, yeah, you can't swim the length of the pool. It talks about what you can do, not what you can't do. And the last thing here is that you model. You know, so if you wanted to, again, going back to the stand-up, if you were doing something on what makes something funny, use lots of different models and allow the students to come up with the criteria based on what they're seeing versus just handing the criteria to them. If they can see it, then the rubric will have a lot more meaning to them. Sorry. Didn't want to do that. There's a couple of things, resources I wanted to point out to you that would be really helpful. And again, I have the links in the slide deck. From the Asia Society, they have these four domains of global competence that are excellent. Omar, can you repost the slide deck again? The four domains of global competence, and they also have this SAGE framework, which is great to help you in redesigning your tasks, as well as with problem-based learning. There's a great organization that has a lot of these elements in there. Again, the link's there. And just as a review here, these are the components of a strong, authentic task. Open-ended, students create original products for an authentic audience, choice and voice for the students, and there's parts that are collaborative as well as individual. Feedback and reflection during, not just at the end. Formative and summative assessments with clear success criteria. So unfortunately, we're 30 seconds away, and I'm hoping that you're excited about this work, as well as there may be some challenges. Feel free to reach out to me through email or through Twitter, and I'm happy to take any questions like that offline. Again, thank you for your time. I really appreciate it. I hope this stuff was meaningful to you. And again, I look forward to hearing from you guys outside of this session.